My postdoctoral period was the time when I started working on gap junctions, and this was 1988, and at that point they had just started to be cloned and sequenced, so we didn't know too much about these proteins that we now call connexins. There was just two of them that had been identified, and now there's 21. So it became kind of clear to me that this was a growing field, a field that we didn't know very much about. And I really like working on molecules that take you into different organs of the body. Gap junctions are kind of nice because every tissue that we have has gap junctions in them. So there's many great questions that came out of those kinds of studies. Gap junctions are these channels that allow two cells to connect and to send small molecules back and forth. It's a big family. It's 21 members of this family, so you kind of think of it as a lot of different combinations of channels that can occur. And so the complexity of this signaling is very large because of the nature of these channels. We don't know exactly what goes through all of them at different times, but we know that very small signaling molecules can go through, metabolites can go through them. And if we don't have them, this is why you end up with various types of diseases, because you need that for a healthy tissue. It became clear that in the sort of mid-90s that these molecules were linked to diseases. And at the time, we didn't know exactly how extensive that was, and cancer became pretty clearly connected to connexins. And so we started thinking that maybe we could study them in a variety of tissues and organs, and we focused in on breast cancer as sort of our specific area of interest. The other thing that happened in the 90s was that it was the first time that children were identified as carrying mutations that had mutations in the genes that encoded connexins that caused diseases. And the most prevalent one is hearing loss. Now we realize that there's about 16 different diseases that are caused by mutations in the genes that encode connexins. So I think Western gave us a really good environment for that. It's one of those situations that if you get good people around you, you can do good things. And I've been very fortunate to be able to get lots of good people in my lab over the last 15, 20 years. And that really helped the lab flourish.